In this video, we'll take a look at attributes in ICE. The purpose of an ICE tree, or in fact of any operator in general, is to control an effect such as this bump on the grid. The way that an ICE tree controls an effect is by setting some data in the scene. For example, this tree is setting the grid's point positions based on the null's position. The data that you can get and set in ICE are called attributes. Getting data simply means reading the current values from the scene so that you can use them in your calculations. Setting data means writing it to the scene to change the current values. There are pre-made compounds for getting and setting specific attributes. These can be convenient to use when you are building ICE trees, but you don't really need them because the basic get data and set data nodes can be used to get or set anything. In addition to the point position attribute, there are many other attributes available. For example, particles have attributes for shape, color, size, orientation, velocity, and lots more. Let's take a closer look at an example. This scene has an emitter grid, as well as an empty point cloud with a very simple ice tree. The top branch adds particles to the cloud at random locations on the grid, and then the bottom branch simulates them. If you play back, you can see that the particles are being created, but they're not moving. That's because there's no force or velocity attributes defined on them yet, so the simulate particles node has nothing to work with. Let's stop the playback and drag in a set data node to see what attributes are available to set on the cloud. Some of the attributes in this list already exist in the scene. For example, every particle clearly has a point position. Other attributes like point velocity are available, but don't actually exist until they've been set. This is also true of shape, size, color, mass, and other attributes that make particle simulations fun. Let's add some of these attributes to the cloud. For a start, pick color. As soon as you do that, the color widget appears, and you can use it to change the color. But you'll notice that the viewport hasn't updated. That's because the tree has already executed for this frame, so it didn't take into account the new color that was set. You can get the viewport to update by advancing a frame. This works because the set data node is plugged directly into the ICE tree root, so color is being set every frame. If the set data node was plugged into the onCreation port of the addPoint node, the color would get set only once when each new particle gets emitted. One way to see your changes immediately is to perform them on frame 2, which is the first frame of the simulation after the initial state. However, there aren't many particles emitted yet on this frame. Because the values are being set every frame, you can also play back while you change values to see the result of your changes as you work. Set the loop option if your simulation is short. Alternatively, you can stop the playback and change the simulation play mode to interactive. Let's add more attributes to the cloud. This time, pick shape. Now you get a drop-down box where you can pick one of these values. Try cone. There's no change in the viewport yet. That's because the particles don't have any size. So add another set data node and pick size. Size is a scalar, so this time you get a slider where you can set a decimal number. As soon as you set a non-zero value, you can see the shape too. Let's set one last attribute. This time, pick point velocity. Now you've got a vector with separate sliders for x, y, and z. Let's set a positive value in y for the velocity and play back again. Now that the particles have a velocity, the Simulate Particles node is moving them properly. Increasing the Y value speeds them up, and decreasing it slows them down. One thing that you might have noticed about the attributes in this list is that even if they don't all exist on the point cloud yet, I still knows what they mean and what kind of data they should be. For example, you can't use a vector to set the size attribute, and you can't use a scalar to set point velocity. Some of the other data types in ICE include Booleans, which are true-false values, as well as integers, matrices, character strings, and so on. We'll look at each of these data types in more detail in other videos. For now, just keep in mind that different attributes have different data types. Another important aspect of attributes is that different ones are available for different types of geometry. Let's use a getData node to see what attributes are available on the grid, which happens to be a polygon mesh object. There you can see that point position is available, just like on the point cloud. But there are others, like point normal and edge crease, that apply only to meshes and not to particles. Other geometry types like curves and NURBS surfaces also have their own unique attributes. Now, the fact that an attribute is available to get doesn't mean that its value can be set. Let's use a setData node to see what attributes are available to be set on the polygon mesh. Some attributes, like edge crease and point position, are still in the list, but point normal isn't there. Point normal, and other attributes like polygon area, depend on the underlying geometry. The normal, for example, depends on the shape of the mesh, and the area of a polygon depends on the positions of its points. So you can get these values and use them in your calculations, but you can't change them, except indirectly by changing the point positions. A powerful thing about ICE is that you can define your own custom attributes. Custom attributes are useful if you need to save values and use them later, maybe in the same ICE tree or in another one higher up the stack. You can create a custom attribute simply by entering a new attribute name, for example, grid.myCustomValue. The setData node stays red because ICE doesn't recognize this name and doesn't know what data type it should be. You need to force its data type by connecting a value of the type you want, which could be either a constant as shown here, or the result of some calculation. Right now, this custom attribute isn't very useful because it doesn't affect anything visible in the scene. In fact, ICE is optimized so that it won't actually calculate and store the attribute in such a case. You can even change it to a vector because its data type isn't being forced by anything else in the scene. That's something you can't do with the predefined attributes. However, that will change as soon as the values get used somewhere else. Let's look at a different example that uses a custom attribute. This sample scene uses setParticleAgeLimit to set an attribute called ageLimit when each point is emitted. ageLimit is a scalar that's intended to represent the particle's lifespan. But like the custom attribute we created earlier, it doesn't affect anything by itself. Later in the tree, however, deleteParticleAtAgeLimit compares ageLimit and age, and then deletes particles if they are too old. So as a result, the sparks die out after a short time. There's one final aspect of attributes to talk about, and that's data structure. So far, all the attributes you've seen have been a single value per element, such as one scalar or one vector per point. But sometimes there's more than one value per element. For example, each vertex on the grid has two or more neighbors, which you can see if you get and display the point neighbors attribute. So the point neighbors attribute is not a single value, but an array of values per point. An array is simply an ordered list of values. You can specify individual elements in the list using their index. The index of the first element in the list is 0, the second is 1, and so on. In other videos, we'll go over using the nodes in the array category to manipulate data in arrays. But for now, all you need to know is that attributes can have one of two data structures, either a single value or an array of values. So to summarize, attributes are the data that you can manipulate in ICE trees. You've seen how different attributes have different data types, like vectors or scalars, and how they are either single values or arrays. You've also seen how different geometry types offer different attributes, and how some attributes are read-only. Finally, You saw how you can create your own custom attributes for any purpose you want.